Hi guys, today I'll take you to the intriguing Guyaju, which was discovered in 1984 and is at least 1,000 years old. Guyaju is a cave complex located on the steep slopes of a granite mountain close to a plain near Beijing. With neither historical records nor datable archaeological evidence, the true origin of who constructed Guyaju remains a mystery. The name Guyaju means ancient cliff dwelling. This fortress-like cave system comprises 350 chambers within a system of 117 caves. Carved on both sides of a secluded gorge, archaeologists discovered relics from people who lived there during different eras, but concluded that these inhabitants were not the original builders. The rock dwellings are in three clusters, covering an area of 24 acres or 100,000 square meters. The caves were created from granite, an igneous rock, very resistant to weathering and very hard to carve. How did ancient builders excavate these granite caves on such a massive scale? Guyaju tool marks are similar to the large uniformed marks found at ancient sites in Asia, Middle East, and Europe, which I discussed in my previous videos on why they resemble modern-day machine marks. It remains baffling that ancient people around the world chose to construct these labor-intensive, huge stone structures instead of using local wood, adobe, brick, or rammed earth. Guyaju is special and unique in that it doesn't resemble other Chinese archaeological sites discovered from this era. The site has survived more than 1,000 years of weathering, which likely deteriorated most of the original details. One can only imagine how beautiful these caves must have been in their original glory. The entryway of Guyaju has a rock guardhouse. Passing the first guardhouse, there is a long uphill walk leading to the second guardhouse, followed by a steeper climb to the real entrance to the cave compound. Passing another checkpoint, you will find a narrow entryway leading to the interior of the cave system. Guyaju is designed like a fortress. It's impressive to behold. There are about 8 stories of caves forming a complex system. The thickness of the walls and the floors between each story is consistent at about 20 to 30 centimeters or less than 1 foot. This detail shows both sophisticated engineering knowledge and advanced craftsmanship. Many dwellings have multiple stories interconnected with corridors, steps, and stairs. Inside the caves, there are high thresholds, windows, room sections, stoves, wall niches, and a drainage system. Some caves show beam holes and fading awning marks. We have to admire the ancient engineers for their ingenious designs. These are not primitive caves. The original stone stairs are very steep, and the tourists use the new stairs to visit the caves at the lower level. The original stairs are carved from stone and slope between 45 to 60 degrees, which are steeper than today's normal stairs. Besides the stairs, we see two ditches looking like cartwheels. The unusual thing is that the initial steps are like footprints. I'll circle back to this later and show you similar ancient steps I found in America and Europe.
The honeycomb caves are of different shapes and sizes, rectangular, round, or square. To our current day standards, these caves are quite small.
Many doors are about 5 feet, and most people need to bend to enter. Some caves are only 4 square meters or 43 square feet. And the large ones are a few hundred square feet. Average room heights range from 1.5 to 1.8 meters or 4 feet 11 to 5 feet 11. For these reasons, scholars assume the community that resided here couldn't exceed 1.6 meters or 5 feet 3 in height. Present-day humans are a lot taller than people from even 60 years ago. Ancient Egyptians in early dynastic period were about 5 feet 3. Ancient Greeks and Romans are about 5 feet 5 to 5 feet 7, which is less than 1.7 meters. Ancient Chinese are about 5 feet 3. So it's not surprising that original cave builders were our smaller ancestors from the distant past. Many caves have low channels with ledges on four sides, which historians propose to be the central heating system called Khan. Khan was used by northern ethnic groups such as Manchurians. A Khan is very similar to a Roman hypocaust. It's a system of central heating in a building that produces and circulates hot air below the floor of a room. The difference is that a Roman hypocaust was for floor heating, while a Khan is specifically for beds used by multiple people. Here I'm showing you how a Khan is built. The structure clearly resembles the channels at Guyaju. If one places a wooden board on top of the ledges, then it can be used as a cozy bed with radiant heat. That'll be ideal for a cave-dwelling family in the North Mountain Range. Khan is still used in some areas in northeast China. People sleep on them this way, making it easier for everyone to get out. Manchurians also use Khan as a gathering place and a dining room. The sizes of the Khan beds at Guyaju correlate with the small rooms, doorways, and the low ceilings. The largest and the most complicated structure is called Guantangzi, meaning chief's court, which is a collection of 8 chambers expanding over 2 floors. There are stone Khan beds on both sides of the main room. This chief's court is located at the bottom of one of the rock clusters, which could be used as a communal place for meetings or ceremonies. There are about 7 to 8 similar yet smaller cave systems in the nearby mountain ranges. Here are some photos from 2 such sites. This cave was built on an almost 90-degree rock angle with a high-up entrance. The stone steps to the entrance looks like a carved ladder and are difficult to climb up and down. That's a smart way to protect the cave dwellers and their possessions from both wild animals and other invaders. Even if someone managed to climb up, the climber would be putting themselves in a very vulnerable position for a possible blow to the head. Clearly, the caves were built with defense in mind.
Guyaju caves are very intriguing, yet not unique. They share many similarities with other ancient cave systems. Next, I will show you a few.
Here is Bandelier National Monument in New Mexico, United States. The caves here are also carved on steep cliffs. The cave doors are also high up with lines of beam holes. Remember the peculiar footprint stairs at Guyaju? Here is the New Mexico version. Aren't they similar? Here I'm showing the cave city of Varzea in Georgia, Europe. The rock dwellings look almost identical to Guyaju caves. A major earthquake in the 13th century shook away the outer walls of many caves and exposed the cave rooms. I think Guyaju encountered a similar situation, which removed part of the outer wall and exposed interior rooms. Here is a photo of the footprint steps at another cave city in Georgia. They are like cousins, both the Georgia and the Guyaju stairs. By the Tigris riverbank lays the great ancient city Hasakif with their cave dwellings, which are similar to Guyaju. The marvelous underground Danrokuyo has preserved examples on how space were used in ancient times. The stairs and steps between levels, niches, and interior windows are all similar to Guyaju's cave dwellings. Here are cave houses in Spain and Italy. Some are still used today as dwellings or bed and breakfasts. They'll have rounded doorways, separate rooms, and multiple niches. The Italian caves have beam holes on the exterior, like the ones we have seen on Guyaju. Besides sharing interior details, I noticed that these cave systems share two common characteristics. They are close to a water source and positioned on steep slopes. Guyaju is near a big lake. Varzia in Georgia is by a river. Hasankeyf is by the Tigris. Bandelier National Monument is by a stream. Proximity to water is essential to most residential settlements. Cave dwellings on steep slopes act as fortified residences like castles from the Middle Ages. Caves on high slopes are comparable to the mock castles built on mounds, wherein both offer the advantage of higher elevation. Guyaju's gateway is similar to the medieval gatehouse. Both are narrow and located in hidden spots. The upper level of a cave system can work as the keep, which is the highest tower inside a castle. It remains better protected and secure from invasions with an ideal lookout.
These cave systems share much in common, which makes me think of the possibility that a widespread cave carving technology built by a widespread civilization existed. Let's briefly talk about current theories on the purpose of Guyaju caves.
Some historians think the settlement of Guyaju was created by the Mongol tribe Xi in the Tang Dynasty, which is about 1300 years ago. Records say this tribe might have stayed in this region for only 30 years before they moved further northeast. This tribe might have used these caves, though it's hard to imagine, let alone prove, they were also the builders. If they really build these caves, then why wouldn't anyone find such cave systems in the regions that the tribe moved to and settled in later on? Other theories, including that a cave complex was built for food storage or beacon towers along the Great Wall of China. Both theories are absurd. Food storage is generally done in a barn or silo, not in hundreds of rooms on multiple levels. Real beacon towers along the Great Wall look like this, a single four-wall structure built with bricks. Nothing at all like the complicated Guyaju caves.
This is why they're so worthy of continued scholarly study. If you have any insights, please leave me a comment. I would love to hear from you. If you like my video, please give me a thumbs up and subscribe. I have a wide range of topics that I want to share with you. This is Curious Being. I'm Tina. Thanks for watching and see you next time.